Hello students, hope you are having a good day. Today we are going to start a new topic of balance. You've already seen the topic. This will be a brief revision about the introduction part only. The assessment and management will be a different lecture. So going through just the introduction of the part. So what is balance first of all? So balance is a condition in which all the forces acting on the body are balanced such that the center of mass is within the stability limits, the boundaries of the base of support. You already know what is center of mass and you already know what is base of support. So for a healthy individual, this will be the center of mass and this is the base of support. So the property or the ability of an individual to maintain the center of mass within this base of support is termed as balance. In other words, we can say balance is defined as the ability to control the body mass or center of gravity to the base on the base of support in order to maintain an upright posture or a functional equilibrium in dynamic activities. Normal postural alignment in standing can be examined by observing skeletal alignment using plumb line. I hope you know what is plumb line. We are going to see what is the plumb line. In sagittal plane, plumb line is positioned just in front of the lateral medullus. So plumb line is a hypothetical line passing through the center of gravity, which is maintained within the base of support. So see the plumb line, see the surface landmarks. It moves through the ear lobe. It moves through the shoulder joint. It moves midway of the trunk. It moves through the greater trochanter. It passes through slightly anterior to the knee joint and slightly anterior to the ankle joint. These were the surface landmarks. Now see the bony landmarks. It moves or passes slightly behind the coronal suture, through external auditory meatus, through cervical vertebral bodies, through lumbar vertebral bodies, through sacral promontory, slightly behind the hip joint, slightly anterior to the knee joint, slightly anterior to the ankle joint, and through the calcaneocuboid joint. Yes. So why is it important? This defines how the alignment of the body will be on other segments of the body parts. Balance system comprises of three things. First is sensory, second CNS integration, and third is motor. The most important part that we are concerned with is motor and sensory for now. Sensory, we'll see the sensory system includes the vision, somatosensory, and the vestibular system. These systems provide information through to the CNS about postural correct control and balance. We'll see all the three in detail, the first one being vision, second somatosensory, and third vestibular. So vision serves an important source of information for ability to perceive movements and detect orientation of the body parts and orientation of body in the space. This ability is known as visual proprioception. We already know what is proprioception. It is ability to sense the motion. To sense the motion with the help of eyes is termed as visual proprioception. So vision gives you how your body is aligned. You can see your body alignment, that is visual proprioception, that allows for feedback for the balance. Second, somatosensory inputs include the cutaneous and pressure sensations from body segments to contact with the supporting surface. They provide information about the relative orientation and movement of the body in relation to the supporting surface. So if we go back, if we see the plumb line, the most important somatosensory will be given by the foot, by the ankle, knee, hip, and the trunk, and then the head. Yes. So most important, the contact surface, the foot will be, and the most important joint, that is ankle joint, will be helpful in providing somatosensory inputs to the brain, how the alignment of the body is on different segment levels. And the third, the semicircular canals and otolith organ of the vestibular system are important for maintaining balance. We already know the function of the internal region of the ear. Semicircular canals detect angular acceleration and deceleration forces acting on the head. Otolith organ detects the linear motion. So when our head is moving into side flexion, at that time all the motions are governed by, sensed by semicircular canal. The motion is governed by three semicircular canals placed at 90 degree of each one of them, and the linear motion is sensed by otoliths. Second is the CNS integration. This was about the sensory inputs that the CNS gets. During quiet stance, all inputs contribute to the maintenance of the posture. If any one system is affected, then CNS is dependent on another two systems for the balance maintenance. So as we have talked, three systems, vision, somatosensory, and vestibular. If any one is hampered, other two's function needs to be improvised or increased for normal maintenance of balance. Third important thing, motor system. Motors, that is muscles closest to the base of support, are important to maintain the balance. Two motor fix strategies are included. First is the supporting strategy. Second is the change in the supporting strategies. So moving forward, fixed support strategy, that is hip strategy, ankle strategy, and second is the change in supporting strategy. You already will be aware about the strategies, still a brief about them. So ankle strategy describes postural sway control from ankle musculature level. This strategy acts when the sway is small, slower, and near the midline. Example for ankle strategy would be a person, a friend of you standing in front of you, and you try to push very slightly. What changes will be in his posture to maintain the balance? His ankle will only move into plantar flexion, dorsiflexion, inversion or eversion, depending upon the angle of the force or the direction of the force. Second, hip strategy. This is the postural sway from pelvis and trunk. It is seen when the sway is larger, fast, and nearing the limits of stability. When the same example, a person and friend standing in front of you, you push him slightly more, yes, with some more force. At that time, the center of gravity from upper body moves slightly towards the boundaries of that individual's base of support. At that time, the hip muscles try to compensate that. Yes. So if the force is slow and if the force is small, that time ankle strategy will play an important role to maintain the balance. But if the force is larger and fast, at that time hip strategy comes into play. After this, there are also suspensory strategies, that it includes lowering of center of gravity by flexing both the knees, commonly seen in windsurfing. Stepping strategy, yes, it describes steps with feet or reaches with arms in the attempt to re-establish a new base of support when center of gravity has exceeded the original base of support. So for this, consider an example, a small, fast and a powerful push from you towards your friend is given. At that time, your friend will try to step out and increase the base of support to maintain that center of gravity within the base of support. Yes, this will be the stepping strategy. How do we examine? So we'll also cover this part in the next lecture, that is examination and diagnosis and treatment part of balance. But for now, remember double stance, single stance, tandem stance, and Romberg test. You all are aware of these terminologies. First is double limb stance. So if a patient is able to stand with double limb support, then single limb stance, standing on one leg, tandem stance, standing in tandem position, and Romberg test we already discussed in coordination. Also, this was about static. Now we see dynamic balance. So sit to stand, stand to sit, reaching movements, turning, step ups, all these movements can tell you how an individual is dynamically balanced or not. Last being the functional balance test, Romberg test, functional reach test, multidirectional reach test, Berg balance scale, performance oriented mobility assessment, there is POMA test, timed walking test, and dynamic posturography. So from this, remember Romberg test, functional reach test, multidirectional reach test, and Berg balance scale. These are the basic tests you should remember at this point of time. Just the name, we are going to see them in detail. So this is it about balance introduction. Tomorrow we'll be having lecture in the morning. At that time we'll be discussing what all things are to be understood, which are practical based. I'll try to explain you that way, and hope you understood all the points, just the introduction part. Next we'll be moving to assessment and management of balance dysfunctions. Yes, thank you, have a nice day, take care.